I hope you're all well. I hope you're all thriving. Hello, America's beautiful children. We love you. And so today is Thursday, and we have our favorite coach, Coach Robinson, on every Thursday with PE with Coach Robinson. Hey, Coach Robinson.
Oh.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm here. It's a beautiful day outside, and I'm just excited to be here again on Thursdays to give a little bit of, you know, health tips and PE tips.
So necessary, you know, these health, nutrition, planned physical activities, you know, especially being in the house with the children and being able to just navigate through how to do that, right?
Right, right.
You know? And so what we talk about today, Coach?
So today we're just going to touch on, you know, healthy hearts and, you know, heart health. You know, it's May, and there's a whole array of, you know, topics for May. And just really want to talk about not get away from this being Lupus Awareness Month.
Right.
Asian Pacific Islander Heritage Month. You know, normally do the Relay for Life, you know, cancer research, but just to really
mental health.
Right. We don't want to take away from all those great topics. We just really want to talk about how to keep our health healthy. Did you hear what I said? Our heart healthy and just health heart. And what does that look like? How can we, you know, combine the two when we're talking about physical education for young children? So that's our topic today. Would you like me to just jump right in?
You know, no, I was just, you know, when I think of like my heart being healthy, and maybe other people might not think of it this way, but I just, at the very minimum, wanted to have my heart beat right, and make sure that my heart is pumping the blood that it the way that it should be, getting that oxygen, you know, in areas that is necessary to breathe, right? And all of that's combined. And so you know, I'm very aware of the American Heart Association's recommendation, which is 10,000 steps a day. And so when I wake up in the morning, I'm thinking, how can I get the 10,000 steps in from, you know, whether that's going for a 30-minute walk and trying to break it up and just really be aware that I want to reach that goal, right? And so including a physical planned activity into that would help get that, you know, good heart exercise.
Absolutely. And, you know, today is week 10. Goodness, we've been doing a little longer than 10 weeks, but this is our 10th week of logging or tracking our physical activity. So this is day 70 for those that are, you know, going to be clocking your day with us. Today's day 70. And just to wrap our head around, you know, what does a planned activity look like? I know we talked about daily setting up what you should do, you know, the day of. But I also thought about, what if we have parents go ahead and write in the activity that they have planned so that you're front loading your student or your child of what to expect, you know, 2-3 days later, and they can get excited and also reinforce tracking. That is one of the physical education California state standards. I believe it's 3rd or 4th grade. They start learning how to track their own, you know, health and learning how to take their pulse and learning the different areas to take their pulse. Because when you start tracking your pulse and your heart rate and all that, you have live data for yourself so that you can take that into your child's pediatrician and say, you know what, my daughter or my son, they get really tired after PE, or they're not feeling too well after PE, and this is their heart rate. You know, that's why they triage us when we first go to the hospital, right?
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, oh, they called my name, but now go sit back in the lobby, you know. But when we talk about heart health, you know, we're talking not only just, we talked about I think 3 weeks ago, what we put in our body is the energy we put in is going to be the energy that we put out, and how much we put in versus how much physical activity we put out. But not only eating healthy is great for body weight, it's also great for your heart. You know, you can, if you eat healthy, you can lower your risk for heart disease, and your diets include foods with low and saturated fats, so that you're keeping track of, oh my goodness, you know, I know one of my students, because he wasn't eating correctly and we learned how to track our heart rate, he found out he had a heart murmur.
Oh, wow.
He found out he had a heart murmur. So he had to totally do a transformation. And just by tracking, just by eating the right foods, you know, we're talking about high fiber foods, whole grains, fruits, vegetables, and certain fats, you know, fats like olive oil and fish oil would also benefit
omega-3.
Yeah, you already know. And, you know, as a child, before I started really getting in tune with health, mm-hmm. I feel like she's taking fish oil pills, yucky, or omega. What is omega-3? I would never realize from a young child how I was introduced to it. And now that I'm in the field, it's like, wow.
Like, now, at least they had the fish oil pills. My mama had some fish oil, okay? Cod liver, what is it, cod liver oil? That stuff stunk. And I'm like, really? And then, you know, those little vitamin E oil capsules, we took those.
You'd be burping up grease.
He would even, you know, poke a hole in them, like, we're going to use this, put it on all over. I'm like, wow. But now I'm so grateful that she had even introduced us at a young age to just different various levels of health. And right. What does that look like? Having a plant, you know, based diet. Like, I try to keep my diet as plant-based as possible. I know it's not for everybody, but just trying to just make sure that I have the ability for my body to heal itself without right. medication, unless I want, you know, to take medication, but I really don't like to. So, you know, all of that counts. All of it counts.
And I think that when we look at it, you know, I'm very visual. So when I read, I literally like visualize what I'm, you know, reading. And so if I have a visual of what a heart looks like, and you show the pictures of what clogged arteries looks like and how that can stop the blood flow, and you think you get one heart, you get one body. I remember before I met you, Christina, I'd hear Miss Laster say, my son gets one body. Gosh, you're right. You're absolutely right. And so you think some of the heart facts, you know, your heart is pumping blood to the all different parts of your large muscle groups. And the pump works when the heart expands and fills with blood and then contracts and pushes all the blood out to everywhere. And when you're physically active, you know, your heart works harder. Now think about it. If your heart has to work harder when you're exerting your energy, just imagine having that stored fat or that stored, you know, energy that is fat, you have to work twice as hard to get the oxygenated blood to those large muscle groups. And so physical activity raises your heart rate, and your heart beats to fill up with blood and then pushes it out all over the place. And then when you're active, your body needs more oxygen. So that, you know, the air you breathe, and your heart has to get it to all those places fast. So right. When you're active, your heart has to beat faster than normal. And when your heart is beating faster than normal, I usually tell my students, you know, hands on your head, open up those bronchial tubes to get that oxygenated air down to the to the lungs so that it can do its process to get it there. And it's like, okay, breathe in, take deep breaths, you know, take deep breaths. And I think that that's another thing that we really don't realize. You know, we don't really think, oh, let me take a deep breath. Fill my lungs with air so that it can get there. And especially now with these masks.
Oh yeah. I had to teach my son how to breathe through the mask because, you know, he kept like, we were in the store, walking through the store. And like, I realized that, you know, he was a little bit off, and he was like, I feel dizzy. And I said, wait, stop, you know, and I made sure that there was no one within a certain realm of us. Take your mask off.
Right.
I want you to breathe when you put it back on. Right. And so, you know, what I realized is that he had the mask on, but he's holding his breath too.
Right.
You know, and they just, we can't assume that our children know. And so we have to really just teach them. And that was an aha moment for me. Like, okay, I need to make sure that I tell him how to breathe while he has the mask on, while we're out. And not to hold his breath, right?
Right. And you know, it has to be a lifestyle. And mm-hmm. I get really frustrated when I have, I'm not saying I'm the, you know, I think I'm the best PE teacher in the world.
The best PE teacher. We love you here at National Parents Union. That's why we have you every Thursday talking about physical planned activities. Yes.
But I will say, like, I thank you too. Thank you, MPU. I just think
appreciation.
I think it's very difficult too when, for me as an educator, you know, I'll see kids and I'm like, their parents don't realize that they're killing themselves, you know, with what they put in their mouths and not being conscious of what's going on. Now, it's one thing when students, I have a lot of students that take steroids, especially if they have asthma, and that's something you can't help if your body doesn't mesh well with the medicines that are required for daily living. Like for my sons, their daily living. And myself, I had asthma for many years and I just swell up, or if you have a thyroid condition. So there's certain things that, you know, play into kids' weight fluctuation.
Yeah.
I would start to ask questions, but I'm like, as an educator, like, really, your PE teacher from last year didn't teach you how to take your heart rate?
So right.
No, like, coach, I'm so tired. I'm like, check your heart rate. And they check it. I'm like, well, it's within the, you know, the fitness zone it's supposed to be in, or in the zone of where your body's going to start burning that extra energy or that fat. And they're like, oh. And I just cringe, like, we're not teaching these kids really to be lifelong learners if we're not keep going over what's important. You get one body.
You get one body. You know, I always say that. Yeah.
You get one body. And it's like, you know, I get frustrated as well when I think about, you know, for California, it's 200 minutes every 10 days plus recess. And
right.
I'm like, at recess, I'm going like, all they're doing is just sitting there on the, you're not going to require everybody to move. In my class, if we have preferred activity time, AKA free time, you know,
right.
I have a preferred activity that I know the kids are going to be moving, and, you know, I don't have to worry about, oh, they're just going to be sitting. And I tell my students, if you decide that you don't want to do anything else, you have to walk, jog, run around the basketball courts. And I'm like, at least just walking every, you know, 10 minutes, take a breath. 10 minutes.
Right. You know, and so I want to make sure that, because, you know, my children have asthma and allergies. Mm-hmm. And that's something that is genetic and inherited, right? Their dad had it. I have it. And so there's things that, you know, I just couldn't avoid. However, I avoid the allergens, and everyone knows, like, you cannot come around my daughter with citrus because she has a citrus allergy. So that means lemon, lime, oranges, grapefruit, not even if it's in a lotion, right? She immediately has an allergic reaction. My son is allergic to fragrance, right? And cleaning supplies, different types of scented items. But what happens is that when they're triggered, their allergic reaction, it could turn into a trigger for asthma.
Yeah. Right?
And so, you know, when you have to give those albuterol rescue inhalers, their heart start beating fast. And I know this for a fact, even with the nebulizer breathing treatments, because why? I've had them myself. Mm-hmm. I mean, so fast to where, you know, it makes you feel like, oh my God, I want this to go away, you know, it's scary. And so you have to look at that even, and teaching your child how to read their heart rates, how to detect their pulse of heart rate is very essential, because it could go to the opposite side, right? They have asthma or allergies that trigger asthma, and their breathing could, you know, their pulse ox can go low, right? And so they can start feeling a decline. And so having them to be able to understand how to do that can save their lives.
Absolutely.
You know, and so, you know, even my daughter, like, she carries that EpiPen, that's epinephrine, right? And adrenaline, like, that's a life or death thing. Like, if she doesn't understand how to say, I feel like I can't breathe, it might take someone a while to assess that, right? Or I checked my heart rate and it's up or it's down. I need help, right? Help. And so can you tell parents where they can locate, you know, maybe a child-friendly way, a video, just anything to teach their kids to do that check?
So I know WikiHow, you know, WikiHow on Google, you just click in WikiHow and you type in how to check your heart rate. It gives very simple instructions and like visual pictures. For myself, you know, I've taught and I teach my first grade students to find it in, you know, two ways, radio and the carotid heart rate, the two finger, oh, scout's honor, you know, and touch your ears, slide under, now be very quiet, feel that beep, that's your heart beeping. And then they're going like, what? And I said, okay, I'm gonna give you 6 seconds. You're like, wait a minute, 6 seconds. 6 seconds, you count how many times that you feel your carotid artery hitting against your fingers. And then I'm going to say, stop. And they'll be like, oh, I got 12. And I'm like, add a zero. And I'm like, for 1 minute, your heart is beating for 120 beats per minute. So it's even as simple as that. And that's why when you go to the nurse, you're like, how did the nurse do it without, gosh, she calculated that fast. 6 seconds, you can do it 6 seconds at any time. And first grade, my first graders know how to do that. I think, you know, you check with some of the students, you know, I know, they may know, but your WikiHow is a good one to type in. Google, YouTube. YouTube has friendly videos. If you kind of don't know how to explain it to your child, Google the videos and always put in for kids, how to check your heart rate for kids. And they'll give you some really cool cartoons and really cool, you know, graphics so that it'll grasp your children's attention. And then just try it and have them go run upstairs, come back down, take your heart rate. And it becomes a game. Everything's a game, you already know. And that way they can get an understanding of what a heart rate is, number one. Number two, why is it important? And then they'll take ownership. And I noticed that a lot of my students whose parents are either physical educators, something to do with kinesiology, or physicians, children, anything with health, if they have a child, if my children's or my students' parents are any in that health industry, They buy in to a lot of stuff that I'm saying because they've been introduced to it and it's not foreign. And they'll be more willing to try new things for lifelong wellness and physical ed than those that aren't exposed to it. And, you know, my students that have, you know, the critical health reports, they're always apt to listen because they've been in a situation.
Right. Or,
you know, because people that don't have day-to-day allergies, there's a scotoma that comes up and a mental block to say, how is your allergies connected to your weight? Or how is your allergy connected to, like, there's no understanding. And so YouTube, I YouTube everything. And there's this one guy on YouTube. His name is Mike Ginola. It's Mike G-I-N-I-O-L-A. Mm-hmm. He has these, he's a PE teacher. I've been following him for about 5 years now. He has some really cool videos that teach about heart rate, teach about the circulatory system, teach about, you know, health and wellness. And I really modeled a lot of what I want to put out there for my kiddos now that we're transitioning to distance learning, because he's really taken those standards and has flipped his classroom. And he has, it's really cool. So I say check him out as well.
Is he the one with the scavenger hunt?
Yes. Oh, my goodness. Okay. Oh, my goodness. And then he also gives a non-traditional way to PE. A lot of times, like some of the videos that I've recommended, it's like, gosh, that's not my area. He literally put together a scavenger hunt that kids had to go touch, like pencils, as many pencils as they can find in the house. And in my house, we have stairs. So my sons, I mean, they were shooting up and down.
Me too.
And that was PE, you know, disguised. Yes. So it's really cool. You got to check them out.
And, you know, I don't want to miss this opportunity to remind parents to be journaling or logging these activities, planned activities, teaching your child how to read their heart rate, right? Because they are a part of the physical education standards. And it counts, you know, when you have that data to show, like, this is what we've worked on. This is how we've progressed. Here are our milestones, here are our goals. We've met this standard. This is how much time we spent on the standard. And, you know, just having that logged is your proof of what you did. So when it comes to the area of questions, whether my kid's gonna get a grade in physical education or not, guess what? You just had a big journal of what you did, the days, the time that you spent on that content and standard area where you can prove that you worked on that, right? And so that shouldn't be up for debate when you have it all in that nifty physical education log.
I'm telling you, having that log is key. And I had an actual, I'm not the teacher of record when I go teach. I'm like the traveling teacher that goes around, and I don't take roll, I don't do grades or anything like that. I give my input to the students' grades. So I had a teacher email me and ask, you know, how can the student, you know, bring their grade up? And I'm going like, see if they did that PE log.
Yes.
So I'm like, go ahead and email the PE log to them and tell them, you know, they can bring it up that way. And it came in handy in my circumstance where we have enrichment here. So there's a lot of enrichment videos, and I'm not sure if it saves. So just having that PE log was really great. And, you know, simple as going back to how can kids know if they're getting that cardio in, that cardiovascular endurance activity in. You think cardio heart, right? And have the kids put their hands on their chests. And if they feel their chest rising really fast after the activity for at least 30 minutes, they know they've done it. And then ask questions like, do you think reading a book, you know, is a cardio activity? Oh no. Well, let's go outside and go, you know, go for a walk, go for a run, you know, ride our bikes. And I told Natasha, start parking the car, you know, further away from the door. I think we talked about that last week as well. And I'm like, park the car farther, you know, park the car around the corner, walk home. And every time that you all need to go out for anything essential, you know, walk around the corner to go get in the car and create new moments that way. And then when you get home, go ahead and log that time in. It took us 10 minutes to get around the corner and come back. And that's 20 minutes.
Well, you know, yeah, I agree. Don't just park the car far because you got that fancy car that, you know, I might want to ride in one day. And you don't want the doors to get scratched. I get it, right? Nobody wants baskets hitting their cars. A lot of people park far, you know, because they don't want their doors banged in by baskets or other doors or whatever. And that's okay. But at least know that the further you park, the more walk you get in, you know. And also for you daily walkers, you can implement a simple thing into your walking routine by spending that speed walking time, then do a little jog if you have the capacity or ability to do that for maybe 2 minutes. Stop, speed walk, do it again, speed walk, do it again, right? And I noticed that that keeps your heart rate up, gets it up really good, and then it keeps it up for the period of time to so that you did that cardiovascular or aerobic activity.
That's right, absolutely. Absolutely. And take a jump rope with you while you're walking. You know, take weights with you. You know, walk with weights. Take the weights off. Put them back on. And now you're using your back muscles to bend over. You know, if you think outside the box and not too traditional, you know, everything is PE, the way we, and when I say PE, I mean like health is a part of physical education or being physically literate. You know, people don't really realize that physical education is a big part of a child's success in school. There's many, 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 many articles out there and studies to show that when students are physically literate and fit, they have better outcomes. They can, you know, concentrate longer. You know, they feel good. You get better night's sleep and those things like that. And so we're thinking, always think lifelong wellness. What can I teach my child within the health arena, within the kinesthetic arena, within physical education arena, that can get them down the way so when they become adults, they know what to do. They don't turn away from it, you know, and it's just, it becomes a lifestyle. It does.
Yes, absolutely. And so I want to give an assignment that can also become a part of our lifestyle. And that is, you know, if you don't have your child's daily physical planned activities, and whatever you worked on in the area of nutrition logged, I would like to task you parents and caregivers, wonderful people, with starting to just log that, right? And just celebrating the little milestones as you go along. Also, just looking up, you know, have an assignment with your kid, circulatory system, heart health. I know American Association or Heart Association has a lot of information that you probably wouldn't even think you'd find, right? Maybe some infographics or whatever, but just start to get your child to really be intentional about how they are thinking about these things, you know, do some healthy breathing exercises, right? And watch the mask, because the kids are holding their breath when right. they're wearing the mask. And, you know, I discovered that with my son, like I said. And so just those are some simple tasks. Do you hear my bird?
Yes.
Okay. You know, I think we're going to do a National Parents Union special edition for the birds, right? And so...
He's doing it when you talk. He's not doing it when I talk. Socrates.
Yes, Socrates is using the Socratic method right now while I talk, trying to get my attention. And so anyway, let me go back to what I was talking about. Yes, those are ways to really start having a practice, implementing a practice of health and well-being, lifelong mm-hmm. stuff. I have, you know, the food information. What do we eat so that I can correspond it with different moods, right? So for you people that may have some children with some mental health issues, this is a very good way to track. Is this really related to their mood regulation, or could this possibly be food related? You know, could it possibly be the time that we're eating related? Health as far as physical planned activity related, are they getting enough sleep, right? Or is this a part of just their diagnosis, right? And so differentiating that will actually help them, since they only get one body, to understand lifelong how to help themselves.
Absolutely. And then it'll be easily translated when they're in there with their peers. You know, I noticed that the kids that are self-advocates, you know, other students started opening up to them like, oh, I have this, and how can I? And that's what we really want, because again, that's also the social aspect of students being able to advocate for themselves as well as teaching their peers. That is PE. That is being able to have those conversations about how to correct. I think one of the standards is the students have to peer correct each other. I don't know it verbatim, mm-hmm. but they have to be able to assess each other and then accept what someone is saying, you know? And I think that when we look at everything, I think PE teachers are the best. Hey, PE teachers out there.
Shout out to all the PE teachers. Happy Thursday. We're watching Coach Robinson on Thursdays, National Parents Union PE with Coach. Know that you are appreciated. I know that sometimes, you know, traditional classroom teachers get the appreciation, but I so appreciate school counselors, physical education teachers, school psychologists, you know, that are caring and careful and responsive to our children's needs. Coach, you worked across 6 different schools, and I don't even know how you did that in 1 week. You serve 6 schools, okay? We won't go there today, but I just gotta give, you know, a shout out to the non-traditional educators in the education space. They're also making it happen. We appreciate you. And parents, you know, if you want to have a question or feedback or comment, you can always drop it in the comment field. If you want to reach out to Coach Robinson, she's available, jrobinsonpclass@gmail.com. Also, right, it's on the screen. You can contact me, Christina@mpunion.org. I'm available to answer questions, hear feedback or responses. But what I do know that we do want to hear from you guys is what your thoughts are about schools reopening, what it is that you feel is absolutely necessary before you send your child back to school. And so we'll be asking that question over some time, waiting to hear your responses. We're glad that you came to watch today. Have a wonderful day. Is there any final thought you want to share, Coach?
Just turn on that music, get with your family, take a deep breath, get physically active. And I love you guys.
And keep track of it, right?
All right.
And so thank you again. You have been watching Managing Day to Day with me, Christina Laster, National Parents Union, PE with Coach on Thursdays. I hope that you're all well. I hope that you're thriving. Goodbye, America's beautiful children. We love you. And we will see you again on the National Parents Union live page, same time tomorrow. However, if you would like to watch other shows that air throughout the day, you could definitely go on the National Parents Union page. There's shows that come on all throughout the day from the morning to the night. And so we would love for you to take the time to go through those as well. Goodbye. See you later.